SQL Server Big Data Clusters provide security mechanisms to make sure your data access is always secure. Nelly is here to tell us everything about it today on Data Exposed. Hi, and welcome to another episode of Data Exposed. I'm Jeroen, your host, and we have Nelly today with us to talk about security for big data clusters. So, hi, Nelly.
Hi, Jeroen.
How are you?
I'm good, thanks.
Okay, so security for big data clusters, that must sound important. So, can you tell us how that works?
Sure. So, if you're familiar with SQL Server, you probably know that security is always a top priority for us. And it's the same thing with big data clusters. We prioritize this work and know how important it is to our customers. So one of the things, I'm going to highlight some things around the security today. We're not going to cover all the details.
Of course.
But we're basically going to cover on high level so that you know the capability, the security capabilities of the big data cluster.
Okay.
And as you know, a lot of our SQL Server customers are enterprise customers, big enterprises who run, you know, who have Active Directory, need to make sure that all your applications, including SQL Server and big data clusters and all of these solutions, can integrate well with AD.
Yeah.
And that's the key capability that we're enabling in big data clusters in 2019. Is to actually for you to be able to do this in an easy way, a seamless and easy way. Now, I'll tell you why I emphasized easy and seamless, because typically when you're dealing with applications, let's say any type of application, joining an application to AD is not a big deal, right? You know, you just assume that any application supports AD integration. Now, for big data clusters, it's the same thing. You know, it should just work. It's just that we have to highlight that we're running in a fully sort of completely containerized solution here. Where all the services are running in containers and all the supporting services are running in containers. And this is running on top of Kubernetes.
Right.
So we've spent a lot of work on making sure that you get a fully automated and seamless experience of this completely containerized solution.
Okay.
A big data solution on top of Kubernetes.
So basically, this all runs in containers. So that's why, you know, the integration is interesting. So what does it mean to have a fully automated integration? What do I get?
Yes. So for that, you might need a little bit of background. So when you're joining sort of in a service to Active Directory or Kerberos, that's running inside a Linux container, for example, it's absolutely possible. It's just that you have to apply some manual steps to get that to work. Now, imagine you have a solution with hundreds of these containers, with hundreds of services running in there. To do this manually, obviously, would not be realistic, and we don't want to ask that from our users. So by fully automated, I basically mean that we are taking care of the complexity for you. We have a service that's called the Security Support Service. So as part of deployment, that service is going to take some information from you as a user who's deploying the cluster. And then the service is going to basically perform all these steps for every single service in the cluster to make sure that everything is AD joined.
Wow, that's impressive. That's very cool. So basically, I can just let the cluster configure it, and there we go, right?
Yes, exactly.
Cool.
Now, in addition to that, we also spent a lot of time to make sure that we get an integrated security experience. And by that, I mean that, for example, when you're passing a query from Spark to HDFS, because in the big data cluster, you know, we have Spark, you can query data in HDFS. These components already play pretty well together. So these components are, you know, part of the same stack, you can say, part of the Apache stack. So there's a lot of functionality we can already leverage there. But when it comes to SQL Server and SQL Server natively talking to a component like HDFS, you know, that's actually a new functionality that we're introducing, where we have the capability to, for SQL Server query scenarios, I have to highlight that if I pass a query to the SQL Server master instance, it's just a SQL query that's querying over an external table sitting in HDFS, right? So when I do that, we make sure that my identity as a person who wrote, who's issuing this query, is flows all the way through all these different components on the way down to HDFS where the data is.
Right.
So that we can do an authorization check on the actual data. And that's what I mean with integrated security. It's integrated through all these components. So no matter where I issue the query, from Spark or SQL Server, the user's identity is always going to flow through all the way to the source.
Okay, that's very, very impressive and very important to any enterprise working with this kind of stuff, because you want to know your data is secure.
Exactly. I mean, you have auditing, you need you have your audit logs to make sure that they are up to date, and you don't want some service account to show up in those. So it's it's one of the key requirements from our customers.
Cool.
As well. And in addition to this, we also have the integrated experience in forms of how you, for example, interact with the cluster. Uh-huh. You know, we have Azure Data Studio that you can use to connect to a big data cluster, right?
Mm-hmm.
We want to give the experience of a single sign-on in for as many scenarios as possible. So when I connect to a big data cluster, I actually connect to the master instance, but our tools will make sure that I also get access to Spark and HDFS and all these other components that are interesting in the big data cluster.
So that's all handled transparently to me.
Yes, exactly.
Okay, cool.
Yes. And last but not least, we have encryption.
Mm-hmm.
And encryption is very important for our users, right?
Of course.
And we have made sure that all the communication, even internal but and external communication with the big data cluster is SSL or TLS encrypted.
Mm-hmm.
In addition to that, you can, of course, leverage the many different encryption features of SQL Server that we have, and all of them that are supported on SQL Server on Linux, because we're running in Linux containers here.
Mm-hmm.
And we're also working on expanding these capabilities and add HDFS encryption soon, so that we also have those capabilities for data that's sort of encrypted at rest.
Okay. Okay, cool. So can you explain us a little bit more about how this, you know, works under the covers?
Absolutely. So let's focus on authentication first.
Okay.
Because it's important for you to know what different sort of entry points there are to the cluster, right? And mm-hmm. here you see the five different endpoints or entry points to the cluster. Now we have this Kubernetes cluster, right? So we have to basically specifically expose certain endpoints that users or client tools or any applications can interact with in the cluster. So if we start with controller, as you might be familiar with, controller is the brain of the cluster. Controller is the one that keeps track of everything, that deploys the cluster and all of these things. Now, to reach the controller endpoint, you can see here that the main method you would interact with it would be through the AZ Data CLI, but also through our tools.
Okay.
And it's mainly the endpoint that an administrator would use, for example, to interact with a cluster.
Mm-hmm.
But controller also has magic powers. You can say controller can sort of reach out to other endpoints.
Okay.
So you can actually, for example, you can log into controller through AZ Data, and you can, from there, issue commands that will take you to SQL Server Master Instance, and you can start running T-SQL. Or you can run HDFS commands directly in an HDFS shell and these type of things. So that's what that endpoint allows you to do, among other things.
Very cool.
Yeah. Next, an endpoint that you might have heard about if you've used big data clusters is the gateway.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the gateway is actually the same thing. The implementation detail behind this is that it's the Apache Knox gateway.
Okay.
And this is a gateway that typically protects, you can say, the Apache components,
mm-hmm.
such as basically on the Hadoop side.
Right.
So we have Spark, Livy, Yarn. If you want to connect to HDFS through web HDFS, this is the endpoint that you use. As well as from Azure Data Studio. So that's good to know when we're talking about the gateway, what we mean there.
Okay.
And then we have the management proxy, which is, you know, the gateway to metrics and logging tools.
Yep.
And then we have, obviously, SQL Server Master Instance. It's just SQL. It's just a TDS endpoint where you connect to from whatever tools that you're familiar with. And the app proxy, last but not least, which is the way that you can access the applications if you deploy it inside the big data cluster.
Okay.
Now, all these different endpoints, when you're running, for example, in a secure mode, when the cluster is running in secure mode, I mean AD integration mode,
okay.
All these endpoints are allowing AD authentication.
Okay, cool.
So that's what I wanted to highlight here. So when we're talking about AD authentication, it's a full integration with AD.
Right. For all the one of the five endpoints. No. It's across the board.
Exactly.
Wow. Okay.
Yes.
Cool.
So that's authentication basically for you. Mm-hmm. And moving on, we also have authorization, right? It's very important to protect your data.
Absolutely.
And once it's inside the cluster, once you actually manage to log in and authenticate. Yes. So the key parts I wanted to highlight here, and this is still high level. I'm sure that we're going to have additional talks about the details of these things. But on a high level, there are two levels of authorization checks that you do in the big data clusters. If we start with SQL Server, for example, if I'm issuing a SQL Server query, you know, first of all, there are authorization checks on SQL Server objects. I need to have access to the tables that I want to query, for example, so that, you know, we can make sure that I can access the data.
But that's the same authorization checks as we had in previous releases, right?
It's for just SQL.
That hasn't changed.
This is just SQL.
Okay.
It's like, so basically the permission model of SQL Server is the same, whether it's running in big data cluster or anywhere else.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So you can still grant permissions on specific tables and specific objects in SQL Server, right?
Perfect.
Mm-hmm. But in addition to that, now let's take the scenario when I'm issuing a query against data that's sitting in HDFS, and I'm querying an external table over HDFS in this case.
Mm-hmm.
Not only do I need to have access to this table, to the database where this table sits, right? I also need to have access to the actual files and data that's sitting in HDFS.
Sure.
And that's why what I meant with the two-level authorization check. So in this case, there's a check in SQL Server, and there's an additional check in HDFS.
Okay.
On the Spark side, basically the Spark queries will flow and the HDFS authorization check will make sure that the permissions are honored.
Okay. So with all of this, I can be sure that, you know, the original's user identity is passed through SQL Server to wherever the data is, right? HDFS or however I access it, correct?
Exactly.
Huh.
Yes. And then as we sort of touched on before, we'll have this pass-through identity, which means that the original user's identity will flow all the way down to the data, so we can actually verify all the way that this was the user that wanted to access the data.
Okay.
Yeah. So that basically is a summary of on high level on the security capabilities around the AD integration specifically.
Yep.
For big data clusters.
So where can I find out more if I want to dive deeper?
Yeah, so if you want to learn more about big data clusters in general, and we'll have we have security docs covering details of what I just explained today.
Okay.
You should go to this short link, aka.ms/SQLBDC.
Okay.
If you go there, you can learn tons about big data clusters.
All there is to learn, right?
Yeah.
Awesome. So, okay. So basically I need to go there and start learning, right? And start downloading the, can I export it to a big PDF and then, you know, read it in the nighttime to learn?
Probably I can. Yeah, I think you can do that. Yeah.
Don't print it though. Just PDF. Right?
Yes.
Okay. Cool. So thanks a lot. This was very useful. Thanks a lot for sharing.
Thank you.
And thank you for watching. Please like, subscribe, and comment on the video. And I hope to see you next time. Thanks.